He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Welcome to our holiest Easter service here at West Hills Baptist Church. I am absolutely delighted to look out and see everybody here today. It is different in many ways. We not only are streaming in the gym and in the chapel, but folks are at home, and we want to welcome them as well. It makes my day to look out and see so many new faces. You will find a tear-out sheet in bulletin, and if you'll fill that out and put it in the basket, we're not passing any plates, but there's baskets in the pew. And if you'll leave that in there, then that will allow us to find out a little bit more about you and to share a little more with you about all the things that is happening here at our church. We don't have enough time for me to tell you what it has been like for our church this past year, but just looking around you, you can see the results. And today is so special in so many ways. But one way is that we will be baptizing McKenna Franklin, Abigail Franklin, and Faith Franklin. And God is never more pleased than when his children come to the waters.
Ministry on earth. He went down to the Jordan River where John the Baptist was baptizing. And he went to John and he asked that John baptize him. And John resisted, saying, "You should be the one baptizing me, not me baptizing you." But Jesus insisted, and so John did. And we read in Scripture that as Jesus was being baptized, the heavens opened and a dove descended and a voice was heard from heaven saying, "This is my son, whom I love, in whom I am well pleased." As Drew said, God is never more pleased than when one of his children follow him in baptism. What a special time to be able to do that on Easter, as we are reminded that this is a symbol of how we are buried with Christ and raised to walk in newness of life with him. This morning, I get the privilege of baptizing these three girls. Come on down, McKenna. When I came to West Hills almost 9 years ago, these sweet girls were in the two-year-old preschool class, and I have gotten to watch them grow. I can remember seeing them walk down the hall with Miss Betty. It was such a special time. They are in fourth grade at ESK, and McKenna does gymnastics. She's on the premier athletic gymnastics team. McKenna, we are so proud of you, and we are so excited to celebrate with you today. It is my honor to baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. McKenna, God's mark is on you, and he will be with you forever. Yeah. Abigail. Abigail is an artist, and she plays the piano. Abigail, we are excited with you and celebrate with you as well. It is my honor to baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Abigail, God's mark is on you as well, and he will go with you forever. Miss Faith. Faith swims with Tennessee Aquatics. These are some very talented girls, as you can see. Faith, we celebrate with you as well, and it is my honor to baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Faith, God's mark is on you as well, and he will go with you forever. And all God's people said,
amen.
Thank you. you join me in our opening prayer? Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. We repeat our Easter shouts of surprise and joy again and again. For news of your victory over powers of death and evil is news so startling, so amazing, so different from the news that bombards us day by day. Beyond our comprehension, you startle us again and again, even today, with resurrection life, bringing grace and hope and joy. You and your risen power are shaping all of our days, and so today we praise you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Would you take your bulletin and join me in our responsive reading? Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's steadfast love endures forever.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
The Lord is our strength and might.
Today the Lord has become our salvation.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone.
This is God's handiwork.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Before we have the Lord's Prayer, I just want to tell you a quick story. Years ago, when we got word that the Franklin triplets were coming, we rolled out the red carpet. We had a big sign over the nursery that said, "Welcome, Franklin triplets." And two of them loved it here. The other one did not at all. But she came around, and we are better off for them. We're so proud of them and so glad to have their family here this morning. Will you join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Easter. And what a special time to get to celebrate baptism. You know, this is a day when we celebrate the fact that, like we talked about last week, Palm Sunday and Good Friday were not the end of the story, but that thankfully resurrection came on Sunday morning when Jesus rose from the dead. And because of that, we have the promise of eternal life with him. Isn't that a wonderful thing? I am so thankful for the sacrifice that Jesus made, but I'm even more thankful that on Easter Sunday, we get to celebrate the fact that Christ is risen. And because of that, we have the promise that someday we too will be able to be raised with him. I love the picture that baptism gives us of how just like Jesus went into the tomb and came out again, we go into the water and we come up. We've talked about before how the water in baptism is just a symbol, but it's a beautiful symbol, a beautiful picture, because when we ask Jesus to be in our hearts and when we decide to follow him, he washes us clean, just like the water in the baptistry. And we become a new creation. That's one of my favorite verses in Scripture. Therefore, if anyone's in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. Thanks be to God that his great gift of love poured out through Jesus and celebrated with resurrection gives us hope that even though we are human and we all fail, we have his love and we have his forgiveness that will see us through. And that is something to celebrate. Will you bow your heads and close your eyes and repeat after me as we pray together? Holy God, thank you for resurrection and the promise of eternal life with you. Help us to share that good news with everyone we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Children, if you will follow me, we're going to go have extended session. Parents, we will be behind the gym. That's where you will find us after church today.
Sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruin sinners to reclaim. Amazing. bless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be?
Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Isaiah. This is from the 25th chapter. Hear what the prophet from so long ago would have us hear today on this Easter morning. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from the faces and the disgrace of his people. He will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Son who is risen, let us be happy with that. Thank you for everything you've done for this past year and a half for all of us. We've been able to get through these very difficult times, and we will always be grateful for that. Please be with those that are unable to be here and give them peace and joy knowing that they are in our prayers. Be with our church and help it to remain steadfast in these hard times and difficulties that we're going through. Please bless these tithes and offerings, and may we use them to glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
I remember years ago when our second pastor, Marvin, came, we used to sing the doxology at the beginning of the service, and he changed it to this part of the service, which actually theologically is more sound. And I thought to myself, that's not when we sing the doxology, and it totally messed me up. Of course, I got used to it. But now, every time this moment comes, I just so look forward to the day when we can have congregational singing, and just like all the other things, they're still hanging out there. There's still a light at the end of the tunnel, and that day will be coming. Our New Testament reading this morning comes from the letter that Paul sent to the Christians who gathered in Corinth. This is chapter 15, verses 12 through 26 and verse 58. And he sends these same words to the Christians who gather here on Easter at the West Hills Baptist Church. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom if he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. He's saying that the very cornerstone of our faith rests on the resurrection. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ, then comes the end when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and every power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word, and may the message that he intends for us become a part of us.
Serve the Lord.
Man, I'm just going to have to let that sink in for a second. That was powerful. We have got so much to cover this morning. Whew. I hope nobody made any reservations for 1 or 1:30. You know somebody at home is going, "Preacher, I'm going to have to hit the pause button. If you go past 1, we're going to be all right." Let's talk about this last year. If you were going to choose a song to represent the last year and what it's been like, what kind of song would it be? Would it be a happy pop song? Pharrell? Would it be an energetic rock and roll song? Or would it be a sad, sad country song? That sounds like a no-brainer to me. Everybody's been cooped up for a year, being told what can and can't do. Years ago, I'll never forget, I went to this James Taylor concert when he announced he was going to sing a George Jones song. He said, "This song is so sad, it'll make your dog cry." Then he even had to one-up that when he came back to the microphone. He said, "This song is so sad, it'll make your roof leak." The song was called "She Thinks I Still Care." Here's a couple lines from that song. "Just because I asked a friend about her, just because I spoke her name somewhere, just because I saw her, then went all to pieces, she thinks I still care." Whew! That is sad. Turns out Rolling Stone did a magazine article on the saddest country songs of all time, and wouldn't you know, George Jones had several on the list. This is what they said about him. They said, "Trying to decide which of George Jones' songs is sadder than the next is like trying to decide if coal is blacker than midnight on a moonless night." Isn't that great? But the time came, and when they had to come up with the saddest song, and it was not "She Thinks I Still Care," the song that they chose was called "The Grand Tour." And this song is about a husband's walk through an empty house after his wife left for good. And it was the story of George Jones' painful divorce from fellow country music star Tammy Wynette. But here's the kicker. The guy who co-wrote the song with him was a guy named George Ritchie, who ended up marrying Tammy Wynette 3 years later. So can you imagine what it was like for him to have to sing this song? Now, if that's not a song to make your dog cry and make your roof leak, then I don't know what is. Oh, this past year in this pandemic, I just hate that everybody has had to go through it. I hate that my girls had to go through it, but they've adapted just fine. I have to give them credit. They were already on their devices in their rooms all the time anyway, you know. And at the beginning of the pandemic, I was making them get out, and we would go to every park in Knoxville and walk around. And then last summer when school let out, they wanted to stay up all night and sleep all day. And I fought that. And then I just asked myself, what am I fighting here? If my kids want to sleep through, if their rebellion is that they want to sleep through a pandemic, I think, I'll just be good with that, you know? When I was growing up, my parents were just worn out by the time I came along. They didn't like it if I got in trouble in school, but any other time, they were like, "Are the police involved? No? All right, well then, you know, he'll figure it out." And I really didn't experience any tragedy in my life until I was about 19 years old. And that year, my grandmother died, and then we had a guy that grew up with us in the youth group that was killed in a car accident. And then we had another guy in the youth group that was killed in a motorcycle accident. And it was as if it went from nothing to be concerned about to this flood of things that I had to deal with. But nothing in my lifetime has been anything like what we have experienced in the last year. It's really hard to get your mind around these numbers. All of us know people that got the coronavirus. All of us know people who are a little sick. Some of us have really been put through the ringer with this thing, and it's still hard to wrap your head around this. More people have died in our country from this than the last three wars combined. I think we can all agree this has been a dark year. I have to tell you, I come to this Easter with greater need than any other year of my life. The miracle of Easter, this is the event that is placed over all against all the darkness that we may face in life. And as a minister who sees ministry as an honor, because I get invited into the lives of people when they're hurting, I can tell you this past year has really been painful for people in so many ways. I recognize the need in people more and more each day. So I must tell you this morning that we gather here today with great need. And I believe that we as a people recognize this need, maybe more than any time in our lifetime. The miracle of Easter is full of mystery, but it meets us where we are, particularly at a time like this. So let me ask it this way. Does Easter, in fact, correspond to where you find yourself today? After everything that we as individuals, as a church family, and as a people, is it the answer that we need for what we have been through? You know, we've all been through a lot, but there are people in this room today who are struggling. There are people in our chapel who are struggling. There are people in our gym who are struggling. We've got people at home who are really struggling. Does the miracle of Easter speak to that struggle? Does it, in fact, speak to the other side of the grave? We've all heard a lot of Easter sermons. If we are Christians, we believe in eternity, right? And if we have just a few years behind us, then we know that life includes tragedy, just like those disciples experienced 2,000 years ago. We need to hear about history. We need to hear about eternity. We need to understand our present circumstances, but it is difficult. Some people are so obsessed with the hereafter that they lose touch with history. Others are so immersed in today's problems that the mystery of death is irrelevant to them. There are some who believe that it is arrogant on our part to even believe in an afterlife. Do you remember that song that Sting recorded several years ago, "One World is Enough for All of Us"? However, we as Christians were created to live in both worlds simultaneously. It is almost odd sounding, isn't it? We here on earth are bound by time, but God is not bound by time. And what we do here has eternal implications. That's hard to grasp. It's hard to admit that what we do as Christians is not all about us. Just like it was not all about the disciples 2,000 years ago. What happened and what they encountered had the kind of eternal implications that have caused us to gather in a place like this in 2021. The truth of the matter is, the disciples got to witness so many incredible things firsthand. All of the miracles, all of the sermons, seeing how Jesus interacted with people, how he looked into their eyes, how he touched their souls, and they still did not get it. The disciples, all the way up to the cross, did not get it. Think about what they witnessed there in the end. Within a matter of hours, they see Jesus arrested, tried in a kangaroo court, convicted. What do you think was going on in their heads? Try to get inside their heads for just a moment. Is it safe to assume that they thought God was going to intervene? And instead, they see Jesus crucified, and killed, and they watched as his body was put into a borrowed tomb. And as the rock was rolled in front of it to be sealed, they sat and wondered if God was ever going to do anything. Now we know that real love does not die with a physical death. We are not a body with a soul. We are a soul with a body for a time. So time here and eternity are all intermingled. And the miracle of Easter addresses both sides of the grave with hope. You know, we could go around the room this morning and each person could tell what the last year has been like for them, particularly for those who have lost someone that they love. In that context, I want to share with you what it was like to hear my mentor tell his story. Dr. Claypool went to Southern Seminary back in the heyday of Baptist life. Soon thereafter, he became the pastor of Crescent Hill Baptist Church, just off the campus of Southern in Louisville. That was considered one of the premier churches in Southern Baptist life back in that day. And I tell you that just to paint the picture that Dr. Claypool was already known for being one of the most effective preachers in Baptist life at that time. But a few years after he began his ministry there, his 9-year-old daughter was diagnosed with leukemia. She was given about 18 months, and it was almost 18 months to the day when she passed. I cannot think of anything more painful than for a parent to have to bury a child. As you can imagine, his grieving was very public for him. But through a whole lot of prayer and a lot of intensive therapy, he finally came to the conclusion that his little girl was never his possession. She was simply a gift. And he had to learn to be grateful to God for the time he had with her and not resentful to God for the time lost. You can imagine how well attended his sermons were when he came back into the pulpit. Back in those days, it was very unusual for ministers to make it personal to talk about themselves at all, but he did. And that series of sermons were eventually published, and he was able to help thousands of people with grief through his books. 30 years later, I'm sitting in a room with him at my seminary in Atlanta, and he shared with us what he chose not to disclose in his books. After he came to this revelation that his little girl was never his to possess, that life is a gift, to dwell on the gift and not allow resentment to darken your soul, after he found comfort in that incredible perspective, he did what any husband would do. He went to his wife to comfort her. And on that day, in that classroom, he told us her response. She said, "If what you say is true, then God is an Indian giver, and I don't ever want to hear you preach about hope again." Here are two people who went through the exact same tragedy, but came out at opposite ends of the spectrum. When I talk to people about tragedy in their lives, I tell them it is completely natural to have both thoughts. But at some point, one will dominate the other. Which do you believe reflects the true nature of God? The most important aspect of Easter to me is that it speaks to the true nature of God. That first Easter morning, The women arrive, and they see that the body is gone, and they assume for a moment that what had happened was a human event, that grave robbers had already come and gone. And then they were stunned by the fact that it was the work of God, and that it revealed his most basic nature, what God is like and what God can be expected to do. If we miss out on this point today, then we miss the big picture. The Easter event is all that evil could muster all throughout time, not just then, not just all the horrible things happening in the world today, but also all the evil to come. The Easter event is all evil collectively placed up against pure innocence on a sinless man. Evil is never more apparent than when it is inflicted on innocence. That's why we're so disturbed when something happens to a child. Evil is never more evident than in the face of innocence. And when Jesus returned, it was living proof that God had the power to overcome everything. But it is even deeper. What we see is God absorbing all the evil that humankind was capable of over time, and God responding with only love. The Easter event is revealing to us who God really is, his true nature, and what we can expect God to do. There is great mystery associated with the miracle of Easter, but we get a glimpse into the way that God relates to what God creates, and what God loves, he loves eternally. Have y'all seen this show, American Pickers? All these people who watch this show consider themselves pickers now. These guys drive all over the country buying and selling stuff. But let me ask you this, does it not appear that these guys overpay for every single thing that they buy? I don't know how these guys ever made a profit before they went on television. I'm sure the show makes a ton of money. But I watch every episode, and I'm kind of fascinated by how these guys can find the value of stuff that I would just not see. Let me ask you a question this morning. What if we could all see the value that we have in God's eyes? What kind of hope would that give us in the life that we're living? How would we deal differently with what life brings if we honestly understood the value that we have to God? This morning, I want you to think about the worst things that have ever happened in your life. Thomas Hobbes said, life is nasty, brutish, and short. I have good news. God's love revealed in the miracle of Easter can get us through anything that life can bring, but that is not all. Christianity is not just about forgiving. Christianity is not just about forgiving ourselves or others for the sins that have transpired, the sins that we've committed, or the evil that has been inflicted upon us. In fact, it is much deeper than that. Christianity is about confronting those sins and dealing with them differently because we know what God has done for us. The miracle of Easter clearly does not evade tragedy at all, but it does take evil and transform it into something that God can use for good. That's called redemption, and it is powerful. The last hours of Jesus' life were tragedy at its worst. I'll never forget when I was in the seminary, that was the year Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion of the Christ, came out. And when they got to that scene where they flogged Jesus, I couldn't handle it. It was the only time I have ever gotten up out of a theater and walked out for a minute. But then I came back to watch the rest. I have my own version in my mind about the events of that day, and it is evil with such intensity that it is almost beyond comprehension. It was undeserved suffering on the background of innocence, and God took that event and transformed it into an instrument of redemption for you and for me. God took the worst and made it the best that ever happened all throughout time. My father had a friend that preached here several times back in the 70s. His name was Dr. Jim Hatley. He was a pastor at Second Baptist in Memphis for years. He made this point in a very powerful way. He said it this way: the very fact should sober us when we are tempted to throw the word impossible around in an absolute sense. We simply do not know the hidden resources of reality. Therefore, ultimate despair is always presumptuous. It is deciding something about the future and evil for which there is no evidence. For after all, if God could raise Christ Jesus from the dead and make the means of his death a means of new life for others, how can we know what he might do with our tragedies? No situation is beyond hope, because none is beyond God. The miracle of Easter is that we can walk down memory lane, revisit those things that have shaped us in an ugly way, and cause them to no longer be obstacles in our lives, but have them be transformed into stepping stones to becoming the person that God would have us to be. What we are celebrating today is the healing that you need now. From your past, from right now, and for every day that you have the privilege of still breathing. Someone shared a short story with me years ago about a social worker who was giving a case history to her colleagues at a meeting. She told the story about 10 years before finding a 9-year-old boy who had been hit by a car and had not been given any medical attention for a year. She described him as a crumpled heap of humanity. She got to work and personally called in every favor she could with the surgeons and the hospital for him to get all the medical help he was going to need. 15 months later, he came into her office and did a cartwheel. She said to herself, here, finally, is the evidence of being able to help and to make a difference in the world. And so she said to her colleagues, that was 10 years ago. Where do you think that boy is now? Someone guessed that he had become a surgeon. Someone guessed that he had become a teacher. Another said, I'll bet he became a social worker too. And she said, no, he is in prison for committing the worst crime a human being can commit. She said, but the story did not end there. She visited him in prison, and he had finally been transformed from the inside out. She said, I made it possible for him to walk, but no one had ever showed him where to walk. Behind bars, he finally had an encounter with the risen Christ, and this is his quote. He said, "I know from experience what it's like to be handicapped and to be a criminal, and I can use these wounds to help others." And this woman said, "There is always hope." Life surely has a whole lot of mysteries that remain, but I have to tell you, there is hope because God always has the last word. In this New Testament passage that we read, the Apostle Paul is telling us that if the miracle of Easter did not happen, then we are a people to be most pitied. Do you believe that? The way of Christ does not ease the pain, but it does somehow put a light around the darkness. Do you believe that? Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your past and your pain is not in vain. Today, Christ is risen in you, and not even the grave can keep God from having the last word. Folks, that is good news. Hallelujah. This is the time in the service where we generally give an invitation, and because things are so different, we're doing things a little different. I'm going to ask the Franklin girls to come join me down here, and then I'm going to lead them outside, and we're going to put a table up out there so they can stand on the other side of it, and you can greet them and not hug all on them like we want to do because we're so proud of them. But will you stand for our benediction? May the road rise to meet you. May the wind blow at your back. May the sun shine warmly on your face. May the rain fall softly on your field. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. ¶¶